let me start and just introduce this whole topic, because Tom and I have been labeled by some pretty prestigious people in the world that, number one, they obviously are atheists, slash, I question that, whether they're atheists or they're just basically hidden occultists, probably more hidden occultists, as being the leaders of the transhumanist resistant movement. Now, you mentioned Ray Kurzweil, and there's a whole bunch of authors. And at the end of the day, I'll begin this whole part of the segment of hour one by saying Zoltan Isfahan, a very, very brilliant man, said pretty much, when you come to the logical conclusion of the transhumanists, they simply don't want to die. And they want to, if you will, build a better human than that which they believe has evolved to the state we're at, or devolved. And so what we're talking about tonight, I believe, are the two most important issues facing the church. People will ask me and send me emails, well, what does this do to, what has this to do with salvation? Everything. Because Jesus talked about the end of, if you will, the end of the age. He talked about the time when men would be seekers of pleasure rather than seekers of God. But when you go into everything now in the electronic world, in the computer world, artificial intelligence, every one of probably a thousand new terms are pointing to this. Basically, mankind will become the master of his own fate, apart from God, under the influence and instruction of Lucifer, who became Satan. And just as the Bible specifically states that Satan had his I will statements, the iPhones that we now have, and the, let's say this, the iMac, the I this, the I that, selfies, everything that we are seeing right now is pointing to the time that we are in those, if you will, those end days, as I am a firm believer, and so is Tom. Now, how long they last is open to God's foreknowledge and his ultimate control over time. But again, I want to share something. One of the words we're going to be talking about tonight, and we're going to cover a lot of territory, this is the single most important issue facing the church today. And there are very few people, and that's no surprise to Tom or I, that I think fully grasps the ramifications of what it means to the Christian faith, what it means to the human race, and how it basically is the greatest telegraph, and television preview of the extinction of man. So with saying that, I will turn it over to Tom, and then Tom, when you're done, you can turn it back. But this is, in my opinion, Dave, and thank you for letting us come on tonight, the critical issue that is, whether you like it, whether you believe it's irrelevant, it is going on in the world's laboratories, it is going on in the heavenlies, it is, the war is on for the human genome, and Jesus did not die for the aliens, and Jesus did not die for whatever robots might have the, if you will, the reflection of a human soul, because what they leave out in the whole discussion is God is a spirit. The Bible says God is a spirit, and we who worship him must worship him in spirit and truth. He breathed into the dust of the earth, into the clay man, Adam, and Adam became a living soul. So, you know, the idea is this, is that they will try to do everything, meaning the transhumanists, the hybridizers, there's a new word, Tom, the hybridizers and others, to create, in my opinion, the monsters of antiquity. And no matter how you gloss it over, paint it with pretty paint, underneath is a rot, and that rot is the extinction of humanity. Go ahead, Tom.
Well, thank you for that new word, too. I'll put that in my Quayle forest, right?
Yes.
I have a whole lexicon of terms that have been invented by Steve Quayle, and a lot of them have to do with transhumanism. And by the way, Dave, thank you for introducing your students to Ray Kurzweil. His book, The Age of Spiritual Machines, was for a long time the leading book on the subject of transhumanism and the whole idea. He's a utopian futurist that imagines that we're going to use emerging fields of technology, genetics, robotics, artificial intelligence, nanotechnology, synthetic biology. We're going to use all of these new powerful instruments, things like CRISPR-Cas9 for gene editing, to fulfill the promise that the Nakash made in the Garden of Eden to transform men into gods. Now, Steve and I have been identified by most of those well-known futurist communities out there as the leaders of the transhuman resistance. Not that we ever set out to be identified as such, but because we have been the leading voices from a conservative Christian point of view, raising questions about the ethics. And both of us would say that there is a lot of good that will probably come out of some of these technologies, the cure to diseases, things like that. Our issues arrive when we start talking about modifying what it means to be a human to the point that they are no longer considered to be a human at all. In fact, two well-known terms in these communities is transhuman. So you're a human, but you are transforming into something else. And then ultimately posthuman, where you're going to become something that is so different than what we even comprehend humanity to be that you are no longer considered to even be human. And that was the goal in the days of Noah, by the way. And Jesus prophesied in Matthew 24:37 that that would be the goal of the end times too, as it was in the days of Noah. So shall it also be in the coming of the Son of Man. Well, so recently, Steve and I learned that the peer-reviewed science and religion journal Zygon, which is a really well-known, very well-respected journal, peer-reviewed journal, published an article that had been written by a professor at the University of London by the name of S. Jonathan O'Donnell, who runs the Department of Religion and Philosophies at the U of London, wrote an article, something like 30 pages long, a thesis, called Secularizing Demons, Fundamentalist Navigations in Religion and Secularity. And this article was brought to our attention because as soon as you get past his 16-cylinder title, what he starts talking about is Tom Horn and Steve Quayle and what he calls our milieu, which is the French term that basically means a community, and that Steve and I are the leaders of the transhuman resistance community. And then the entire article just goes into talking about us and our organization, Skywatch TV, Gen 6, the stuff that we do and the people that we work with. And basically he refers to us saying that we're anti-transhumanist apocalypticists, but that the community, the pro-transhuman community, is going to have to deal with us. They're going to have to pay attention to us or engage us in one way or another because O'Donnell opined that Steve and I probably represent a very large but maybe quiet percentage of the community. It's almost kind of like in the 2016 election where a guy like Donald Trump comes from out of nowhere and nobody anywhere gives him any chance of winning. But then we learned that there has been this very quiet grassroots of people out there that one way or another he identified with, and they gave him the presidency and was, you know, more than 50% of the voters. Well, basically what O'Donnell is saying is Tom Horn and Steve Quayle are going to shake the snakes out of the trees, and you guys had better deal with them. So last year, our conference in Branson's at the big, beautiful Palace Theater, which holds almost 3,000 people, was sold out months before the event. It's probably going to sell out this year. I haven't asked Steve in the last couple of weeks where we're at on registration, but I know we're probably more than 50% already, maybe as much as 60 or 70%. And then in addition to that, we had live streaming last year, and we had close to 50 countries of people around the world that were actively viewing the presentations that we were making there. This year is going to be even more important in that we're really dealing with the name of this year's conference is The Hybrid Age. And I can go into explaining, and Steve can, kind of what is meant by that title. But we're also going to have one of the world's leading transhumanists speaking at the conference, a renowned scientist by the name of Hugo de Garis. And Dave, have your students now that they've read Kurzweil's stuff, have them read Hugo de Garis's book, The Ardalec War, because he's not a utopian, he's a dystopian, and he literally believes that as we move into strong artificial intelligence, we're going to give birth to AIs that are going to lead to a gigadeath war and literally billions of people. He almost sounds like an Old Testament prophet because he literally describes blood flowing through the streets up to a horse's bridle. In fact, I accused him of running from his calling because he was an avowed atheist. Now he says he's an agnostic because he can't deny order in the universe, which speaks to some kind of creation. And so we're moving him along. But he was, for 20-some years, he was the head of the Artificial Brain Development Center for China at Zion University. He is a strong believer that we are going to give birth to strong artificial intelligence that day when an AI comes online with consciousness and believes that it is an I am that I am. And he thinks it's going to be very, very bad when that happens. I'm glad you're asking this question because we are there now. This is not science fiction. This is not in 50, 60 years from now, maybe we're going to start brain machine interfacing humans with the cloud and all that. This technology is being developed right now, and it's being driven, by the way, by the Department of Defense, by the Pentagon, by DARPA, the Brain Initiative that was started under Obama. Literally billions of dollars are being invested in the strategy of enhancing humans. Now, if you listen to the intelligence agencies that give information like our Department of Defense, our defense agencies, basically what they're saying is we wish we didn't have to do this, but China and Russia are rushing ahead of us in investments in this technology. And if we don't invest in it, we're in a new arms race is basically what they're saying. And if we don't invest in human enhancement technology, i.e. super soldier technology, that sort of thing, as well as robotics and drones Terminator-like technology, if we don't invest in that, then in a very brief period of time, China and Russia and perhaps other foreign agents are going to impose their will on us, both in the marketplace and in the battlefield. So bio-enhanced humans, to get back to your question, with cognitive abilities that have been under the design budgets and on the drawing board of military and genetic strategy, social engineering for some time, is no longer sci-fi. It's here now. And our marriage with and dependent on machine intelligence is in the very near future. It's already started. We're testing this stuff on the battlefield in places like Afghanistan right now. I published, in fact, I'm getting ready to publish the fourth book by Lieutenant Colonel Robert McGinnis. He'd be a great guy, by the way, on your show sometime. His day job is working at the Pentagon. That's what he does. He's a contractor. He works for the Pentagon every day. They send him all around the world to teach small countries how to conduct war. And the last book that I, the book before last that I published by him was called Future War. And the whole book is talking about what he is allowed to discuss, because there are some things he can't talk about, in terms of both investment and technology that is being practiced. It's being experimented with on the battlefields right now, including mind-controlling robotic devices by thought alone, to be able to set somewhere with a pair of high-tech, kids use them for playing games and whatever, virtual reality systems where you've got people that are being trained to sit and they're watching robotic warfare on a battlefield in some country where they're practicing this technology. And by mind alone, by thought alone, they've developed synthetic telepathy where the people watching the screen are controlling what these robotic devices are doing on foreign battlefields. So all of this is not futuristic. It's here now. The bigger question that I had raised before we went on the air was, when you get past a certain point and you are interfacing the brain with a strong artificial intelligence system, you have created a two-way gateway. meaning that not only is that soldier sitting there and controlling devices by thought alone because his mind is married to a cloud-based system, but that door has opened so that an outside influence could invade your mind, could invade your, you know, most philosophers think of the brain or the mind as the seat of the soul. And you know, for some of the people listening to this program, think back about when you were a kid going to Sunday school, and you would sing these little songs, "Be careful, little mind, what you think. Be careful, little mouth, what you say. Be careful, little eyes, what you see." Because these are gateways into the soul. Pornography illustrates that. What you see with the eye, the way it can affect brain chemistry and the intake drives itself until it creates a greater and greater need. But some religious philosophers would say that also opens the door to supernaturalism, to be influenced by an invasion of supernatural evil. And so through transhumanism, we are set to extrapolate this issue to an entirely different degree. And I'm going to let Steve talk so I don't dominate the show, but when this comes back around, I also would like to raise the issue of ensoulment, which the Catholics are way ahead of the evangelicals in thinking about these terms. Some of the Jewish rabbis are also talking about it, and that is some of the human-animal chimeras that we're creating right now. It was in the news last week that we're creating sheep humans and different things like that for xenotransplantation, for organ transplants. But to what the rabbis have asked is, if you take a cow and you humanize it, to what extent does the human that is having cow genetics integrated transgenically into its genetic makeup become something entirely different? When does it become something that no longer has a soul? And if the cow human doesn't have a soul, and the priest said this tongue in cheek, but if the cow human you've created doesn't have a soul, then can we burn it as a sacrifice? And what they're trying to do is illustrate the tortured ethics that we are getting involved with now. But look, this is happening all over the world. Tens of thousands of laboratories all over the world. Thousands and thousands of them in the United States alone. Every university in the United States right now has a transgenic laboratory where you can buy a mouse with human genetic material in it. So the Rubicon's been passed. We've went through the door. And the questions do need to be asked now, and thank God people like Dave Hodges are getting young people thinking about this stuff, because we need to get engaged.
One of the things that I think, Dave, in answering your question, God originally created mankind in his image, and he created them, Adam and Eve, and people can argue about that, but prior even to the creation of Adam and Eve, there was a pre-Adamic civilization. That's a war. But you talk about, you know, the gap theory, that's a war. But all of the illustrations through myths, legends, oral traditions, every form of stele, every form of rock carving, rock drawing, petroglyphs, every form of transmission of information from previous ages always deals with hybrids. A combination of something that may have some human features, but it has a combination of the, you know, like a satyr or a unicorn or whatever. There's basically a combination, if you will, an unholy alliance. I'm on record as stating that the point is that anything that is modified beyond God's original. Look, I'm for the blind being able to see, the lame being able to walk, exoskeletons, endoskeletons. But what we're talking about, that would be, I would say, in the electromechanical realm. What we're talking about is something far more sinister, something far more penetrating, something much deeper to the very alteration of the genetic code itself. The CRISPR technology, gene splicing. And as just an interesting fact, if it hadn't been for a thermophile bacteria in Yellowstone Park in what's called Mushroom Geyser Pool, the gene editing of CRISPR-9 and the whole, if you will, Nobel Prize-winning discovery of Carrie Mullis made for the possibility of basically editing anything into anything and producing just about any combination you can imagine. And that came out of the smallest bacteria in Yellowstone Park. And so the point is, everyone's worried about Yellowstone blowing a volcano. I tell them this, something beyond a volcanic eruption took place from a microbe in Yellowstone Park that has changed the history of mankind forever. So my answer to that question they're asking, when does an it cease to be human? And the idea is simply that a good example is Jesus died for mankind. The Bible is very clear. Jesus didn't die for the angels that sinned. A casual reading of the Book of Enoch, the Book of Giants, some of the pseudepigraphal works, and Tom has a new Bible that he's giving away that is just a marvelous masterpiece. We're not going to talk about that in great detail, but the point being is that it explains. So that's why I personally and Tom personally have joined ventures for the different projects we're doing, is because we're showing people that there's nothing new under the sun. And so when you deal with, we used to have the word, Dave, reprobates. Now we got reprobots, okay? And that's a reprobate robot, because what you're seeing now is a whole transition. Tom, you remember when you and I first met and started on talk radio, it was pretty hard for people to imagine when I'm saying, hey, guess what, everybody? You're going to see the day when robots are going to come in, sex bots, and that was my term, mm-hmm. 27 years ago. And you're going to see a flocking, you're going to see a fleeing, and then when you add virtual pornography, when you add a sensory sharing, where literally the movie stars are already being, approached on the maybe movie fallen stars are being approached by certain people in this realm to be able to share their experience through shared thought processes. So when you start messing with DNA, deoxyribonucleic acid, and all the different things that Sharon Gilbert's going to be talking about, and by the way, Sharon is a molecular biologist, a very, very bright and gifted writer, very bright communicator, and she'll be talking about that because she is, a molecular biologist. What is critical about Branson is this. And by the way, Tom, just for your information, I think we just went over half point. The reason we're trying to get people to register early, and Dave, you are coming, obviously, there's quite a few people that are on talk radio because it's critical that people get to understand the full ramifications. And I also salute you, as Tom has, for explaining to students, because all a student knows about, basically, the majority of them only think this, oh, cool, I'll be a superhero, and I'll be dealing at Branson with the whole genre of science fiction, but I'll be dealing with what I would term prehistory enunciation of science fiction. Now, there's a mouthful. So we'd encourage people to go on the gen6.com website, and this one is spelled GENSIX.com. And they can put a /conference, or they can go on my website. It's a giant panel registration, because the thing is that the mansion in Branson, that's the name of the venue, is there's other venues going on in Branson. So we've started early so that obviously the true legends, and the name of the entire conference is Transhumanism in the Hybrid Age, that people can get their hotel, motel reservations ahead of time. And that's why the decision was to make it the announcement in January as opposed to waiting to March. And I can only say this, that it's going to be different. And Tom, you know how it's laid out. It's going to be different than anything anybody has ever done at a conference. We will have, I believe, the most consistent integration of science, prehistory, and what I would call post-history, and the future combined, and show people and to literally lead them by the hand to show that there is such a nefarious entity beyond redemption, beyond reason, driven by pure will and hatred for humanity, that is orchestrating all the technology. And by the way, Dave, you were talking, and we were talking off air, Mike Adams, the Health Rangers channel, was taken off YouTube. I think he had 1,700 videos. Timothy Alberino, the director-writer of the Gen 6, my protege, He's the, you know, he's been out in the jungles of Ecuador and of Peru. Our film team came from South Africa, joined with Tim in Peru, and I'm not even going to talk about that, but it all relates to transhumanism. And Tom, I don't know if you saw it, but it says more and more scientists now. It's on the front of Drudge, I think close to the middle column, and I don't have Drudge on my screen, are talking about taking LSD and hallucinogens. The realm of the spirit and the physical, there has been a veil that God placed between those two, if you will, a barrier. And every barrier is being torn down. And when I wrote the book, Genetic Armageddon, Today's Technology, Tomorrow's Monsters, and then 15 years later, I think it was 15 years, I wrote the book, Xenogenesis, Changing Men into Monsters. The subtitle was, I think, even, I guess, an advancement. So we've got reprobate robots, we've got snuff bots, murder bots, in essence, if you will, techno-assassins, we've got the sex bots, and then we've got swarm bots, miniature bots, we've got smart dust. And the thing that I think is critical, and this is what's interesting, Tom, because as you read the milieu, the criticism from the people in that paper against you and I, they actually gave a very telling statement away, because the presentation that I'm going to be giving is on when inanimate objects take on demonic possession, demonic influence. A good example of that from history is the robot Talos. You know, it's rumored that, forgive me, it's not a rumored, it's recorded that Hephaestus built it under Zeus' command. Zeus, by the way, was a fallen angel. So the point is we're seeing this fallen angel threat. We're seeing the entire book of Enoch coming to pass. We're seeing the future as predicted in science fiction that has generally led to this. And Tom wrote the expose on the Vatican's acceptance, getting their flock, the faithful flock, prepared to baptize aliens. I'll give everybody the great bottom line in this. Aliens cannot be baptized. They are not created in the image and likeness of God. Now, obviously, some philosophical Jesuit would question that, but didn't God create all the beings of the universe? Well, that isn't relevant, because Jesus died on a cross, was resurrected from the grave, and we, in turn, are told in the Bible, and by the way, isn't it interesting, Tom, they attack at night and day, but then they have to use spiritual terms to even begin to articulate. How about Ray Kurzweil's book, Spiritual Machines, okay? And Dave, that is probably one of the most pronounced, declarations of future horror that can be made. Demon-possessed machines. I think it was Stephen King had a book about Christine or something that made it into a movie. And I'm not sure if that's a, I could be wrong there, but it's a one where you have vehicles that are basically demon-possessed, cars, trucks, or there were a couple of them, you know, beyond Stephen King. But the point is that, and this is my question before the Lord right now, Lord, where is the transfer point? Where is the interconnect? What is it that will determine when those things become demon-possessed? So when you put this into the spiritual realm, and understand, Kurzweil already has brought the idea of spiritual machines. Now you've got the group. What's the name of that guy that wrote the treatise of, he's not the head of the Tom Horn, Steve Quayle fan club, the guy from Oxford?
Jonathan O'Donnell.
Yeah, Jonathan O'Donnell. But he's using the word demons. Let me clarify for people. I'll turn it right back to you, Tom. A demon is a disembodied spirit. According to the Book of Enoch, according to the early church fathers, who, by the way, all believed in giants in the Genesis 6 account, the idea is that a disembodied spirit was, for instance, out of the body of Goliath. People will lose a very important point in talking about the Nephilim. The Rephaim are the giants, but the Nephilim, in my opinion, are the fallen angel progenitors of the Rephaim. There were giants in the land before the flood of Noah and after. And then we won't get into it tonight, but there's a whole period of time of the Golden Age before mankind was even on the earth. And when you hear about the fallen angels, and one group of them are the Gregori, and the Gregori are singing and begging God and asking Enoch to intercede to God on their behalf. And God says to Enoch, you know, basically, it's not going to work. I'm paraphrasing. It's not going to work, Enoch. And he's saying they should have been interceding for you. So the point is that we are at a time now where demon-possessed machines, the invisible is becoming visible. The barriers are down. As Tom Horn so, you know, opened the gates of my understanding with his statement years and years ago, the gates of hell were open. And it's a point to be made. When a gate is open, whatever is behind the gate is going to get out. And that's exactly what's going on. Go ahead, Tom.
Well, so, Steve, I'm gathering that you are a sociologist or you teach in that field. Is that like
well, my background's primarily psychology. I've been a therapist, been a professor, been a college basketball coach. I've worn a lot of hats. But I have my undergrad in soc, and I've taught that at the college level. But I'll tell you, and I wanted to interject this, a lot of these people who were repulsed by the topic, I asked them, I said, what if this would be responsible for amazing life extension? And you could live 150, 200 years, and you wouldn't be alone because your friends could live that long too. Would that make a difference? And to a person, they said no. They didn't want any part of it.
Well, that's interesting because if you read, and you can Google this, people listening to the show can Google this and read it, Professor Fukuyama, he is a conservative bioethicist. When I produced a documentary, by the way, called Inhuman. It's a 2-time Telly Award-winning documentary film, and it's got world-leading transhumanists, but it's also got bioethicists, including members of the U.S. President's Council on Bioethics. It's got top theologians from around the world. A little bit later, I'll tell your audience how they can get it free. But it was during the production of that documentary that we did a great deal of emailing back and forth between us and people that work with Professor Fukuyama. His whole thing is that you wouldn't want to live for a billion years. In a transhumanist condition, it would in his mind, it would be equal to being in hell for eternity. Because everything that makes us great as a species is what the transhumanists aspire to abandon. In other words, he goes into almost like the theology of suffering, right? Nobody really wants to suffer, but when we live our lives, we realize that our growth in empathy, what makes us a better individual, what makes us a better parent, what makes us a better friend, you know, quite often are actually the things that we suffered in life that tempered our steel. It made us better. It made us deeper. It made us, you know, more humanitarian. And so his whole thesis is that the very bedrock on which the utopian idea around transhumanism is premised would not just make us inhuman in the sense that we wouldn't be what God made anymore. We'd be monsters. We would become demonic. Because we would be so self-indulgent and lack in caring for other individuals. So I would just say to your audience, I'm kind of getting off track here, but I would say to your audience, go out and Google Fukuyama and read his rejections of the idea around transhumanism. It's very deep philosophy. It's very good. Now, I want to say something about the title of our conference, and then I'll move forward and kind of get back on what I was trying to say earlier about whether or not a transhuman would have a redeemable soul, which is a very important philosophical and theological question to me as a conservative Christian. I realize, Dave, that you have a broad audience and not everybody out there is a Christian, but I'll try to explain to them kind of where I'm coming from and why the University of London is terrified by me and Steve Quayle. But the title of our program, Hybrid Age, and you as a sociologist and with your background can kind of appreciate this because you've probably talked about some of these things too with your students. The hybrid age part of the title of our conference means exactly what it sounds like. It means that what we have already been doing and that most people in the community now are very familiar with, what we've been doing with genetically modified crops, for instance, what we've been doing with transgenic animals, which is mostly being driven by the pharmaceutical industry. You put human genetic material in an animal, you get around FDA regulations for human experiments to test new drug therapies, and that's what drives all of that. Human-animal chimeras, which are being created everywhere. They were back in the news again this week with the human-sheep chimera, again, for the purposes of xenotransplantation. So they all have reasons around why they're doing what they're doing, but we're crossing over species barriers. And it isn't, by the way, just at the embryonic stage anymore. That's what most of these labs would want you to know. Again, you can do the research. I can send information to people that want to email me and ask about it. We're in China right now. We're talking about adult humans who are having their genetic makeup altered using CRISPR-Cas9 type gene editing technology and so forth, and in changing them in ways that are not in line with only the eradication of disease, in other words, for enhancement purposes, something that God himself did not create. So that's what we're going to be covering at this conference, that what we have been doing with animals and crops and whatever, we now fully intend to do to humans. And again, this is not far into the future, sci-fi, Star Trek, whatever. This is today and right now. We're doing it now. By the time we at the September conference, I'm hoping to be able to bring a transgenic animal to the conference with me. Steve's got roboticists that are going to be bringing things there. Gigantic. Maybe I shouldn't be giving up all this stuff. Steve can tell you if he wants to about what he's going to be bringing there. But the point is, we plan to do to mankind what we have been doing with animals and with foods. We're going to hybridize man via genetic alteration, nanotech, synthetic biology, human tech integration with artificial intelligence, brain-machine interfacing, and so on. In fact, one of the scientists that I follow said it this way recently. He said this technology is going to insinuate itself into every sphere and every nook of human activity, from the manipulation of replication of DNA to incrementally integrating with technology, launching an era of change and innovation that we are now calling the hybrid age. He actually stole the title of our conference. And basically what people like that mean for the listener, think of it this way. If the first wave of modern history was agrarian and tribal, and the second wave was industrial, the Industrial Revolution and nationalism, and the third wave was informational, the invention of the internet and handheld devices, and which created a transnational interconnectedness, then the hybrid age is the fourth wave. That we have now entered into the fourth new Industrial Revolution, if you want to think of it that way, and in this new era, human evolution is going to become human technology, co-evolution, I think is the way Steve said it a little bit ago. We're going to become part of the machine. The machine's going to become part of us. But now, with all this powerful new technology, such as the Chinese scientists who have already started gene editing adult humans as well as embryos using CRISPR-Cas technology, we've crossed over this line in the sand that, God help us, somehow one way or another, we have got to wake the church and conservative bioethicists up to speak out on these issues, because it isn't just gene editing humans. The average individual out there, if I use the term germline genetic engineering, they may not know what I mean by that. But that is what CRISPR-Cas9 will allow us to do. So what does germline genetic engineering mean? It means you wouldn't just change one species. You wouldn't just like take an individual and eradicate a disease in them by using CRISPR-Cas9 to snip out a bit of genetic coding that is causing cancer or whatever. You snip it out or some other debilitating disease. Those are all possibly very good things, right? You take it, you literally just go in like a pair of scissors. It cuts the gene sequences. It takes out the bad information. It glues the two ends of the gene sequences back together. And voila, you've cured a disease. So that all sounds really good and dandy. But CRISPR-Cas9 technology and other forms, by the way, of gene editing now also have the potential to make permanent changes at the germline genetic level in sperm, in egg, in early embryo development, which means this. It means that everything born downline from that modified species will also be permanently altered. And this is why some conservative bioethicists are very concerned now, because they're saying, look, this is now the technology that could forever modify mankind. Not just change one individual. This could set in motion the eradication of everything that has been known to be that version of that species from this point forward. And by the way, they've proven this. This has already been proven. The university in California, this is also called gene drive technology. If somebody wants to Google this, look up the experiments that were done out of the University of California, where they took fruit flies and they proved that gene drive technology could permanently alter all versions of a specific species, not just change it, but drive out of existence every previous version of that entity and drive into existence a replacement version of that entity. And what they did was, to prove this, they took fruit flies, which are known to be born a particular color, like a dull brown or whatever their natural color is, and they used CRISPR-Cas9 to change at the germline level the sequence of information that leads to the color of that species, so that it became, I forget, it's either a bright blue or a bright red. I forget which one. I think it was a bright blue. And they did this in a controlled environment. And once that was introduced to the species and they began to rapidly procreate and multiply, literally within weeks, it had driven out of existence every natural fruit fly, and every fruit fly being born was now being born with this new color. And so what they were able to illustrate is that we could permanently alter basically any animal, any species, including a human, through germline genetic engineering. We have the power to achieve the goals of the early eugenics movement. Can you imagine if Hitler had this technology? It absolutely is what I'm talking about. We now have the power to truly reassemble the very nature of humanity into post-human. It's not sci-fi. It's not someday. We have the technology right now to repeat what the Watchers did. Don't forget that in the Old Testament, the reason why God sent the fiat, why he sent the great flood, there's a reason why he did that. It's very clear in the scripture. He did that because it says all life, both man and beast, have been corrupted. And the whole Hebrew language there is dealing with genetics. That only Noah, and therefore by extension his children, had remained pure. And all of the language, Tibultatus, all of the language there, all of the Hebrew words within their context are talking about the DNA, the genetic makeup, that a genetic degradation, and through intermarriage by the offspring of the Watchers, eventually what you had was humans who couldn't even be redeemed. And had had God not sent the great flood to wipe out everybody but Noah and start over again, that would have, all of humanity would have literally been lost, would have been irredeemable. And this, of course, raises this giant question about whether, you know, how far can we go down this road of genetically modifying and otherwise modifying humans, and could we reach a point where they no longer have a redeemable soul? So debate over CRISPR-Cas9, this technology, germline engineering, all of, these are the most critical issues facing the church today. And again, I'm not, by the way, I'm not being cynical. I'm not being critical of churches. But I am scared to death that I don't see really anybody but me and Steve and our milieu, which is why the University of London and the peer-reviewed Zygon said that people are going to have to deal with this. Dealing with what is without doubt the most important theological, philosophical, critical issue, humanitarian, bioethical issue that the Christian community should be addressing today. And it does completely appear that the vast majority of the church is asleep at the wheel. They're not even talking. Well, they're not even engaging the subject matter. And yet we're...
The good and bad, the evil, if you will, the basis of Satan's lie to Eve in the garden that ye shall be as gods, that is the overruling prime directive, Dave, of the entire transhumanism movement. The idea of AI is to try, and the devil tries to do end runs around God, but he forgets that God knows all of the rules and obviously spoke the worlds into existence, while Satan has to manipulate that which God spoke into existence. So the point being is that the whole idea, and by the way, one of the dying CIA station chiefs gave a friend of mine, I'll just say his first name is Will, a deathbed confession. That deathbed confession is in my book, Xenogenesis. I didn't write it. This was a deathbed confession talking about how the intelligence agencies are trying to open those gates to destroy the barriers that God created, to basically allow total hell to break loose on Earth and to totally destroy mankind. Let's face it, you guys, and this is now I'm going into overdrive, Tom. The basis of the all the billionaires are the elitists that are driving the, if you will, the engine of destruction of the human race. Even guys like, obviously, Elon Musk and those people who are, I would say, honest, Hugo de Garas, talking about what this is at stake. Dave, you and I have done talk radio. Tom's done talk radio. In the early phases, we were quoting all these guys that want to basically terminate the human race. And I'll give everyone my next book that will be available, I think, at Branson. It's the, you know, I won't tell you the whole title, but I'll tell you the subtitle, The End of the Human Race. And I don't think people get it. And I'm going to ask Tom to address how in anybody's thinking that humans could embrace that Christians could embrace transhumanism, and if you will, the denial of faith, the denial of redemption, the attempt to forestall the return of Jesus. And the idea is just this. It is a war in the cosmos. And I'd encourage everybody to go on my website, stevequayle.com. I just put up a link directly to my book, Xenogenesis. Chapter 13 in that book is the most important thing. It's that revelation moment when someone who go on to get right with Jesus before he went into eternity, he was on his deathbed, he died shortly after this. The man who gave it to me, his family was listening to this broadcast, not this one with you, but on the same subject matter a couple years ago, and they sent the guy that delivered to me a thank you and saying, this honors my father because he wanted to make right that which he was involved in to destroy humanity. And that's a true story. So, Tom, explain how Christians are embracing transhumanism and that it is like the ultimate, in my opinion, it's treason, it's treachery, it's a denial of faith. Of course, I could be kinder and gentler in claiming they're clueless, but tell and share where that thought process is going to lead, if you would.
Well, beyond anything else, I believe that, first of all, we're witnessing the midnight of Christianity in America as it has been known from the Great Generation until now. What is out there as Christianity? My grandfather would just roll over in his grave to a lot of it. He just wouldn't even know what he's looking at. I think we're seeing the dawn of a new dominant replacement world view. Look at the growth of the Burning Man Festival. Now you've got 60, 70, 80,000, whatever it is, people that are gathering. And notice, by the way, this year, the theme around the Burning Man Pagan Festival is I, Robot. And while they're doing that over Labor Day weekend, Steve, we're going to be having our conference. They're approaching it from the demonic side, in my opinion. And we're going to be approaching these questions from a very conservative, traditional Christian worldview. But bottom line is, look, it's a transhumanist global religious concept that fits well in this generation. That's the reason you have a Christian transhumanist movement. There's really two reasons around it. And I think both of these astonishing statements are provable. The first reason is, and it's actually the lesser of the two, but that is that transhumanism offers a more direct intercourse with supernaturalism than what most of these dead traditional churches do. And that is something this generation wants. Look at everything that is popular, every movie that's coming out. It's all X-Men and whatever. It's all enhanced humans that have superpowers. And look on television at every major popular program that is playing right now, whether it's Netflix or anything else. It all has to do with supernaturalism, interacting with, having supernatural powers. It's what this generation wants. And then, of course, the other thing is that most of these transhumanist Christians really aren't Christians in the first place. They want to attain immortality, but they don't like the methodology that Jesus brought to get it. And they think they've got a better plan. They've completely bought in, if you will, to the lie of the serpent in the Garden of Eden, that there is a way you can become a god, but this Yahweh and his son are not the way to get there. But I want to get back on something we did before the break. I'll try really hard here to be succinct with my language, because I know I have a terrible habit. Dave, I'm an old preacher. I pastored for 25 years. So I have this habit of getting on a pig trail and providing more information than what is necessary.
Well, Tom, before you go down that road, let me interject something, because I want to take advantage of your background. And you had talked about Christianity. Steve broached this topic, and the church and transhumanism. My wife and I attended a service last night here in Phoenix, and the pastor, actually was the assistant pastor giving the sermon, got up, and on the video projection screen, he showed these books. He said, look what people are occupied with today. And it had to do with, you know, witchcraft, making your life through witchcraft, the magic cabal, these kinds of things. He kind of opened the door to approach him. Let me ask you for some advice on air. If someone else is in the same position I am and they've had a similar experience in church, how should they approach their pastor to make it more of an important topic to them? What would you recommend? Where should we start?
Well, I'll tell you something. I hadn't thought about this, but I'm going to do this for your listeners only, and I'm going to give it to them for free. I wrote a whole book on the subject. It's called Forbidden Gate. It was the first book that was widely distributed on the subject matter of transhumanism, not counting Steve Quayle's books. But that book is only half talking about transhumanism. It actually starts with Kurzweil's Age of Spiritual Machines and all that, because I wrote the book about 7-8 years ago. But the second half of the entire book deals with supernaturalism is there an element here that can open a door to demonic activity? And that book did so well that I actually wound up writing, I think it's 270-page-long teacher's guide that churches can use. And a lot of churches have used the book Forbidden Gates as a in-class curricula, but the teacher gets the teacher's guide, which then frames this over a 13-week church class. So here's what I want to tell your audience to do. If you go to skywatchtv.com, skywatchtv.com, you'll also see in the right-hand corner the link there to the conference in Branson. So you can also click from our website. You can go from Dave Hodges' website, the Common Sense Show, and you can go from Steve Squall's website. So you're going to find the place to go and register. And I'm like, Dave, I want you to come. I want to meet you. Steve Quayle will be there. We will all be there, and we will take time to make sure that we get to meet you, shake your hand, talk about your questions. But if people will go to skywatchtv.com tonight, there's a couple of things there I want to do. We have a series of programs right now that are called The Handmaiden's Conspiracy. So it's a new book that's come out. It's really basically just talking about how women can also be involved as partners in preaching the gospel. So if you go there and you click on that ad, you can buy that book, The Handmaiden's Conspiracy. But what's more important to this show is that when you do, I'm going to give you several things. And I know that my warehouse tomorrow morning is just going to be griped at me. They're going to be mad. They hate it when I do this because I make this stuff up and then they got to deal with it. But I'm going to give you a brand new Bible that we have published. But this Bible's unlike anything you've ever seen before. It's a deluxe simulated leather, red letter edition, the 1700s version, common King James version of the Bible, it's all that. But this book also has 18 of the apocryphal books published in the back of this Bible. These are the books that Peter, Jude, other disciples and apostles both read and quoted from when it came to this ancient story about the Watchers, the Book of Enoch, the Book of Jubilees, the Book of Jasher, and all these other texts that were commonly used by the disciples of Christ. Later on, because they weren't considered to be canon, they were considered apocryphal or pseudepigraphal. Little by little, they stopped even publishing them in the Bible. But there was a time in the early church when all of the followers, that's why when you go to the Dead Sea Scrolls, the Qumran text, you find copies of the fragments of the Book of Enoch and so on. But that's where the story came from. Those are the oldest texts that actually tell the story of the Watchers who came down and modified humanity. So I'm going to give you this Bible. This Bible is going to sell for anywhere from $80 to $125. There's nothing else like it in the world. It's the most collectible thing that you could get your hands on right now. And if you go there, click on that ad for The Handmaiden's Conspiracy, I'm going to give you that Bible free. There's some other books there we're going to give you free, but two other things because you're listening to Dave Hodges. I'm going to tell my warehouse to also give you free the two-time Telly Award-winning documentary, Inhuman, which goes into all of what we're talking about tonight. And I'm also going to tell them to give you the book, Forbidden Gates, and the teacher's guide that will show you how to put this into 13 weeks in any kind of home Bible study, church, whatever, that will give you all of the pertinent things that you need to be discussing right now and be aware of in terms of what is happening in the technology. Now, if I can, very quickly, Dave, I know we've only got 40 minutes left, because I've said two or three times tonight this question, will genetically engineered, modified humans, will they have a soul? And secondly, is there an esoteric or supernatural element to this? Can I just say something about that very quickly?
Yeah, absolutely. Please do.
So it isn't just Tom Horn. You have the secular, some of the world's leading transhumanists. For instance, the director of the Future of Humanity Institute, a professor of philosophy at Oxford University, Nick Bostrom. He's one of the most well-known transhumanists in the world. He is a leading advocate of transhumanism who sees other dimensions, other modes of perception being opened via via human enhancement. Either you, Dave, or Steve a few moments ago raised this question that's on, evidently it's on, I haven't been to Drudge tonight, but it's evidently over there, where more and more professors are using LSD, other mind-expanding psychotropic drugs, in order to expand their consciousness to a higher level of whatever. Well, Nick Bostrom from Oxford University envisions remanufacturing humans so that we don't have to use mind-expanding drugs. We can permanently alter the chemistry of our brains through merging ourselves with animals, plants, synthetic life forms, and so on, through, you know, recombinant DNA, CRISPR-type genetic engineering, transgenic sciences. And if you go to his website and you read, well, he earned his PhD writing a thesis called Transhumanist Values. Go there and read it, because you'll see when describing the benefits of combining man with beast genetic material, he cites how things like this, how animals have sonar, magnetic orientation, sensors for electricity and vibration, other extra-human abilities. And he uses those to describe how the range of sensory modality for normal humans, as opposed to transhumans, could be greatly enhanced. We wouldn't be limited, in other words, to those things that are natural to humans. We could add what comes from animal, DNA strands. He talks there how there's no fundamental block to adding, for instance, the capacity to see an infrared radiation or to perceive radio signals, perhaps to add some kind of telepathic sense by augmenting our brains. Well, here's the bottom line to this. Bostrom is correct in that the animal kingdom does have levels of perception beyond human. Some animals can sense earthquakes. They can smell tumors. We've shown this over and over again. Others, like dogs, can hear sounds as high as 40,000 hertz. Dolphins even higher, something like 80,000 hertz. It's also known that at least some animals see wavelengths beyond normal human capacity. And that's where things start getting kind of interesting, and I think supernatural. I'll tell you why I say that in a moment. But it's something that Bostrom may understand and even anticipate, and that is according to the biblical story of Balaam's donkey, certain animals can see into what we call the spirit world. Do you remember that story? Dumb Balaam's making his predictions against Israel, and now he's fleeing. He's on a donkey, and he's beating the donkey with a whip, and the donkey keeps turning off of the path, and he doesn't know why. Well, as you read the story, you realize it's because the donkey can see something Balaam can't see. He can see a giant angel standing in the middle of the road with a sword drawn, going to take Balaam's dumb head off for prophesying against Israel. So animals can see, and there have been some very interesting studies on this. And again, I need to not get off track here, but some studies where, like dogs, sometimes seem to be reacting to something that we can't see with our normal eyes. The little dog runs under the bed and it's barking at something, and you get like the hair standing up on the back of your neck, but it's not something we can see, but they do sometimes seem to be reacting to something. So, but what Bostrom is saying is, instead of just using mind-expanding psychotropic drugs, or what the New Testament in the book of Revelation, chapter 9, might call pharmakia, instead of that, we could permanently alter the brain's chemistry and put ourselves into contact with other entities that might be there, supernatural gateways that exist within the mind that could be achieved through altered mental states. So that we don't have to use DMT or absinthe or some of these other kind of chemicals. So here's the deeper question. Do transhumanists or do military scientists that are spending so much money now on the brain initiative starting under Obama, do they imagine kind of a permanent pathway, a connection with the beyond the ability to see into other dimensions of the spirit world as a result of brain enhancement through integrating men with beasts. The whole storyline in the Book of Revelation is very interesting in Chapter 9, where it talks about, you know, an angel comes down with the key to the bottomless pit, opens up the bottomless pit, and all these insectoids start coming up out of the earth and torturing humanity. But read that chapter through the end. It says, and yet, and this is talking about those being tortured, it says, and yet they repented not for their, the Greek word, pharmakia, for their effort to open a doorway into supernaturalism using these mind-expanding drugs. So mankind is evidently intentionally trying to open a door to another dimension when this angel comes down and says, you asked for it, you got it, here they are, right? And yet they repented not of their intentional efforts. So, but this is happening in universities. I apologize here. I know I got to go quickly. The Arizona State University Templeton Foundation, they're funding a long series of mostly pro-transhumanist lectures over there called Facing the Challenges of Transhumanism, Religion, Science, and Technology, where they, too, some of the instructors there, are talking about radical alteration of Homo sapiens that could open doors to unseen intelligence. They've been talking about this. In fact, you might recall a few years ago, they actually, Arizona State University, launched a study to explore the discovery. It was called the Sophia Project. Do you remember this, Dave? Do you remember this,
Yes,
Steve?
Yes, I do. Yeah, I do.
Yes.
Yeah, and the whole point about it, you can cue it and still read the. They've taken it down since then because Steve and I went on and did a bunch of programs, and so they took it down. But the Sophia Project, the whole point about it was to explore the discovery and communication with entities. And then they even went into describing what entities they were trying to put themselves into contact with. It's Greek goddesses, deceased people, spirit guides, otherworldly entities, extraterrestrials, universal intelligence, something that others maybe call God. So there is this spiritual side. And imagine what this could mean then if government laboratories, working with unlimited budgets, SAPOC budgets, beyond congressional review, are even now decoding the gene functions, the DNA coding that God forbade, that the watchers crossed over and led to the judgment of God, that can lead animals to have what? Preternatural capabilities of sense, smell, sight, snakes that can see into the ultraviolet array. When I came down off of Mount Graham, up there where the Lucifer device is being used, that's what it uses. It uses infrared, like serpents have. And that infrared technology in the Lucifer device on Mount Graham, you can go to Google and type in infrared UFO and see side-by-side illustrations of deep space imaging that is happening with non-infrared tech and the Mount Graham Lucifer device. And on the one not using infrared tech, you don't see anything, just deep space, bunch of stars. Go to the other one, and it looks like a literal armada of UFOs flying around in deep space that can only be detected with infrared technology, like serpents have. And DARPA has already publicly written how they want to try to give super soldiers this type of infrared-type technology. So there does seem to be a purpose that is operating behind the screens that has in its mind something that would modify at least entire populations of soldiers, genetically engineered Nephilim agents, if you want to use that kind of language, but humans who could hypothetically see into and maybe interact with invisible forces that the Bible would describe as demons or fallen angels.
No, I was going to say it's the gates of hell. It's the gates of hell, Tom.
Yeah. Hey, Dave, let me tell you something. I'll try and find it and put it up. But I was contacted by somebody who has dealt with a scientist out of the United States that literally you would declare is a takeoff on Rowdy Roddy Piper's They Live movie. And what he's been able to do, Tom, is utilize the laws of optics and some of his proprietary stuff to literally see into the spirit world. I was told 10 years ago by a multi-star general, active duty, ultra black, that means they don't even exist officially, that they were able to basically put night vision and thermal imagers in a very thin, if you will, contact lens. So they've already done that. The idea is to, though, put it in your DNA. Ultimately, I want to make this clear. People talk about D-wave computers. They talk about quantum computers. They talk about the next phases. The ultimate computer will be your DNA. The ultimate transhumanist attenuation will be your DNA. The latent power of the soul. In other words, Adam was pretty smart to name all of the animals. It's almost like God in his mercy closed the certain parts of the brain and the sensory, let's say, skills and abilities of fallen humanity so that they wouldn't be sidetracked by all the multiple dimensions. I won't even go one step further, Tom. As I was praying about today and what you and I would be talking about, even Balaam's donkey, and this is confirmation to me, I felt like people need to understand something. What they're doing in human brainwaves, they've already done with animal brainwaves, and so pretty soon you'll be able to communicate with your pet, and your pet will be able to communicate with you because they'll be understanding the words. What is it, the average dog, Tom, 500 words? Some of them are in the thousands. So I want people to understand something. Now, that sounds cool. I love my dog. You know, my dog's a labradoodle. His name is Cyrus, and I'm convinced he can spell, okay? I truly am convinced he can spell. But the point is that we're coming to this fissure because, again, observation, we're limited in observation. The conclusions we draw are based on our observations. But when you get into the multidimensional reality of even going into that realm where the Bible says, I have not seen nor ear heard nor entered in the heart of man at any time, those things that God has prepared for those who love him, I think the thing that people are misunderstanding and not getting, we're talking about a preternatural, P-R-E-T-A, natural, supernatural, beyond a human experience, realm of existence or existences that now are being opened. And again, I tell people this. You know, I watched this dumb thing on Drudge or something about the Vatican needs exorcists. I said, great, 7,000 sons of Sceva. The sons of Sceva tried to cast out demons in Jesus' name without knowing who Jesus was. So the point is that here's the thing, and again, I'll say this, Tom, and thank you for it, but all the gates are open. And what they admit to you guys publicly is far from what exists privately. For instance, I'll tell you this. I think it was in June we sent a team down to the jungles in New Guinea. It wasn't Tim Alberino. It was a couple other guys, a filmmaker and a former minister, pastor, missionary to some of the wildest tribes in the world that are still inhabiting the highlands in New Guinea and also the islands of the Solomon Islands. And interestingly enough, Tom, there's a story amongst the natives about deep underground military bases and an escapee who talked about the experiments that were going on in combining human and animal DNA. And what was interesting, one of the people that broke free of it was a nun. The thing is, you'd say, well, she's just crazy, she got taken, abducted, whatever, until you find out that all of the natives are terrified. And then here's where it gets interesting, Dave. Here's where it gets really interesting, Tom. This area on the coast in New Guinea, obviously the highlands, but they're looking towards the ocean, the people are terrified of the lights that come and go into the water. So, you know, obviously the island of Dr. Moreau which I'm dealing with in my next film, the point that I'm trying to bring out to everybody, and I don't want to get sidetracked, is that, Tom, what you're saying about Balaam's donkey came into my heart today on the whole thing of animals. But what we know exists versus what really exists, and I'm talking about transgenic species that are straight out of the myths and pages of mythology and tradition and legends, legendary beasts, that many of those things exist already. So when people ask me this, well, you guys are just trying to scare us. My word to you is simply this. Go read Isaiah 54, 15 through 17. And the 17th verse is the one that's really famous. It says, no weapon that is formed against you shall prosper, and every tongue that shall rise against thee in judgment thou shalt condemn. This is the heritage of the servants of the Lord, and their righteousness is of me, saith the Lord. Jesus said he gives us power to tread on serpents and scorpions. Notice that. Notice even the beasts that come out of the bottomless pit. I have on my alert section, Dave, I don't know if you've ever seen it or Tom, but eyewitnesses who were in Ecuador that saw the very creatures that are in the bottomless pit. And I think what I'll do is post it on my website tomorrow for people that can see it. But a woman and her child, her son, not a little baby, but her son, basically were watching and in the distance, and this thing flew right up to him, exactly described in the book of Revelation. So what's interesting to me is that you're now seeing people having supernatural encounters, events, and you even look at the UFO encounters. Now, what does all this have to do with transhumanism? Simply this. All the barriers that God put in place, in my opinion, are open now. They're down. Everything that God said was good, and by the way, in Genesis, the first chapter, and God said it was good. There are seven, and God saw that it was good. So it's interesting to me the number of perfections, seven, in all that God created. Therefore, the enemy who is beyond redemption, beyond reason, beyond salvation, I'm talking about Lucifer who became Satan. You look at Isaiah, what is it, 14, you see his I will be like the Most High God. I will ascend in the mountain of the Most High. All of that is interesting when you come to the iPhone. And the iPhone is, I will just say this, it's like the Apple computer and the Apple with a bite taken out of it. Most people forget the Apple computer came out at $666. So the forbidden fruit now is even translated into the activated genes. So whatever God turned off in the latent powers of the soul, or the old statement, Dave, you've heard, Don, we only use such and such a percentage of our brain, and women can use both sides of their brain, which I believe is true. The point being that we are now going to experience enhancing and releasing, but with the enhancing comes the demons dancing, okay? That is my attempt at, forgive me, Randy Conway, but that is my attempt of saying this. With the enhancing, and remember, every single thought now they want to read, the idea of pre-crime, just like the Minority Report, Dave, this is beyond Pandora's box. This is the world now that is going to be seen, because God is absolutely going to make it real, real and revealing. And this is why the conference in Branson, Missouri. Look, we don't just, this, Dave. We have a half a dozen speakers, and we don't, and I'm not taking shots at anybody in this, but we are so focused, Tom and I. Tom wanted to retire from speaking, and then I guess we got a second wind, Tom, because you knew the calling that was God on your life. You couldn't be silent in this, because this is the most important thing affecting the world. And God, I wanted to go back into my man cave. 20 years on talk radio, I never had a picture of me on the internet except one old one. And now I have to come out of my man cave. But the point being is that we now have to stand against this stuff with all our might and all our strength. And by the way, the Bible says the righteous are as bold as lions. So some of the people that are trying to shoot us down in the world of Christianity, obviously they're not, believers, they've got to understand their future is at stake. Their children is at stake. And the fate of the human race is at stake, so much so that Jesus even said, you know, when the Lord returns, will he find faith in the earth? And my answer to that is, Lord, wherever you've got your people, you'll find faith. But if the days weren't shortened, there'd be no flesh left alive. There'd be no flesh spared. And Tom, that's the clearest prophetic utterance that I know that Jesus spoke as to the end from the beginning. In other words, it's a very powerful and poignant point that Jesus is trying to get. And God said, Dave, he says, the Bible says, his people are destroyed for lack of knowledge. And that's why Tom Horn does what he does. That's why I do what I do. And all the others will be speaking at Branson. Branson is an anomaly. It is not a Me Too thing. And is that a fair statement?
Yeah, and by the way, I think, you know, it's probably unlikely to even happen again. It's really kind of a one-time thing. We're bringing all of the top people from around the world, both scientists as well as theologians and bioethicists, to discuss where we are, and I'm looking forward to it. And you're right, I was trying to retire. In fact, last year, if you recall, Steve, I told you I don't want to speak anymore. I don't want to do it. And I've been turning everybody everywhere down. I'm not even speaking at the Oklahoma conference with the other people this year. But you drew me out of my shell, and I knew that I owed you. So at first I just did it out of debt. But then I was very, very happy that I did. It changed me, and I realized, look, we can't afford to stay in the man cave right now. We can't afford to stand down, because nobody else is doing it. And it's a particular and peculiar calling that God has given you and I. Something I should, by the way, say, earlier I said if people go to skywatchtv.com and click on the Handmaiden's Conspiracy, it's all on the top of the website. You'll see it easily with any kind of a device. If you buy the Handmaiden's Conspiracy, I'm going to give you this free Bible and all that. Well, but I forgot to say what you need to do if you go there, because there'll be hundreds of other people that'll just buy that tonight anyway. When you check out, there's like a comments page where you can add language. You need to type in there, I heard you on the Common Sense Show, or I heard you on with Dave Hodges. Make sure you put that in, because that's the only way that the people in the warehouse are going to know to give you this new Bible with the 18 apocryphal books, the Inhuman documentary, the Forbidden Gates book with all of the materials, the 270-page teacher's guide. The only way they're going to know to put all that stuff in that box with that other book is if you say, I heard you on the Common Sense Show, or I heard you on Dave Hodges, because this is exclusive to the listeners of this show. This is not something we're advertising to everybody else, so need to make sure you know that. The other question that I just don't think we're going to have time, but let me at least introduce the idea, Steve and Dave, and it's because this question comes up to me more than any other question, and maybe, Steve, it does to you too. People emailing me wanting to know, will a genetically modified, altered human, do they have a soul? Are they redeemable? That question comes up over and over and over and over. And it's kind of creating distress among some people today that imagine that this is the world their children are growing up in. And, you know, biohacking is becoming a thing. People are injecting themselves, as dumb as this might sound, they're injecting themselves with CRISPR-Cas9 kits. I have one of these kits. I got one of the very first ones through a bio lab. I've taken it onto television with me. I've talked about it. But there's no way in the world I would, you know, stick a needle in my skin and inject it into myself and see what it, you know, might do. But people are doing that. So there's a lot of distress right now over this. And will altered humans have a soul? Are they modern Nephilim? What are they? Will these creations, in the Judeo-Christian sense of the word, will they have a soul? That is, the soul of a human as different than the nature of an animal, in that man alone was made in God's image and we are his imagers, and the essence of the human person is capable of union with God now and transcends later from mortal to redeemed immortality after death. Do they have that kind of a soul? And this is a debate that goes all the way back even to the early church fathers through the Middle Ages, when they were talking about the golem, right? These clay creatures that the Jews could create and give life to, that whole mythology, all the way down through the Inquisition of the Roman Catholic Church, about whether modified humans would have a soul. And in fact, the subject of whether hybrid humans that we are already now creating, can they be redeemed? I think I might have told you about this, Steve. I had lunch with the state superintendent of the Oregon District of the Assemblies of God not long ago, and several other state representatives. And while I was there, the soup leaned forward and he said, "Tom," he said, "I read your book. It's really good, but one thing troubled me greatly. The part where human genetics," he's talking about the book, my novel, The Ahriman Gate, "where human genetics are combined with what the scientists in the book thought was maybe alien DNA, and it leads to this revival of Nephilim." He said, "I never liked talking about that subject when I was a pastor because I hate the implications that there could be mutant humans that cannot be saved." Well, he really kind of encapsulated what I think a part of the conversation has to be that has to be discussed right now among theologians and church philosophers and so on, his abhorrence of the idea that something could be made that looks like a human, might even walk into a church, but it cannot be saved. And I said to him, I said, "Look, believe me, I really do understand this issue. I understand why it's troubling to you, but it doesn't change the fact that Nephilim, as described in the Old Testament and in the ancient books that I'm giving away in this new Bible, the Book of Enoch, and similar books, as far as those books are concerned, and those are the stories that Peter and Jude quote in the New Testament canon, those creations were devoid of redeemable souls, of redeemable spirits. In Genesis 6:9, only Noah, and therefore by extension his children, were found perfect, tenium, in their generation, which means without blemish, healthy. It's the same word in Leviticus that's used to describe an unblemished sacrificial lamb. The meaning is not that Noah was morally perfect. We know that he wasn't morally perfect. But that his DNA had not been contaminated. And so when you read, like, if somebody goes over there and they buy The Handmaiden's Conspiracy, they get this big Bible from me that's got these apocryphal works in it. When they read the Book of Enoch, for instance, you have this depiction. Whether or not the corrupted, altered humans that were made by the Watchers, the Nephilim, whether they had redeemable souls. And I've got it open in front of me right here. I'll read it to you quickly, and I know we're out of time. Note what happens when the Watchers asked the prophet Enoch to beg God for the salvation of their children, for the salvation of the Nephilim. Here's what Enoch wrote. "Then I went and spoke to them all together, and they were all afraid, and fear and trembling seized them, and they besought me to draw up a petition for them, that they might find forgiveness, and to read their petition in the presence of the Lord of heaven. For from thenceforward they could not speak with him, nor lift up their eyes to heaven, for shame of their sins, for which they had been condemned." That's Enoch 3:3-5. Enoch takes his petition to God, and then he informs the Watchers of their hybrid children's situation regarding whether or not they can be redeemed. Enoch 14:4-7. "I wrote out your petition, and in the vision it appears thus, that your petition will not be granted unto you throughout all the days of eternity, and that judgment has been finally passed upon you. Yea, your petition will not be granted to you, and from henceforth you shall not ascend into heaven unto all eternity, and in the bonds of the earth the decree has gone forth to bind you and all the days of the world. And that previously you shall have seen the destruction of your beloved sons, talking about the Nephilim, and ye shall have no pleasure in them, but they shall fall before you by the sword, and your petition on your behalf shall not be granted, nor yet for your, nor yet on your own, even though you weep and pray and speak all the words contained in the writing which I have written, Enoch 14:4 through 7. So the bottom line is, this is what the Watchers did. They modified humanity. Then they begged Enoch to please go to the God of heaven. And by the way, if somebody's listening to this and they're saying, well, who cares what the book of Enoch says? Well, Peter did. Jude did. The disciples read this book. In fact, the disciples had the book of Enoch among their canon of scriptures. It was only later expunged during the 15th century. Because there were people in the church at that time that didn't want these books to be part of the Bible. I'm not even arguing, by the way, to make this a part of the canon. I'm saying that the disciples quoted it as scripture. They quoted it as a trustworthy document, a historical document that told the true story of what had happened. So this is the only example we have. I could theorize, lots of people could theorize, the only example we have of whether or not genetically re-engineered humans that are modified to the extent that they are no longer human, whether they could be redeemable or not, we only have one example in history, and it is in the book of Enoch, and it's it says, absolutely not. They do not have a redeemable soul. So why am I pointing all this out? I'm saying that this is the reason why the church desperately needs to get involved in this conversation, because
gentlemen,
otherwise, if they don't, they're leaving it to the so-called Christian transhumanists who are out there right now saying that it's part of our duty to be involved with God as co-creators, and
no.
The only way we're going to bring immortality to mankind is to permanently alter what it means to be a human through both genetics, robotics, artificial intelligence, gene therapies.